And in continuation with this webinar series of computer assisted designing and manufacturing, here is this topic about biomaterials for computer assisted manufacturing. Why, what is the need for this topic? With rapidly evolving computer assisted manufacturing, every year some or the other product is coming up with their new indications, advantages, disadvantages. So this presentation will give an insight into the biomaterials to be used with this process of computer-assisted manufacturing. And it's not just a hearsay. This particular presentation is not what I do in my clinic. Instead, this is a very evidence-based presentation as to what the research says, what the various clinical trials on the various materials for computer-assisted manufacturing have been published in the literature. So this particular technique is applicable to all spheres of dentistry, anything which requires fabrication, from burnout patterns before conventional casting to custom tray to copings to crowns to implant supported restorations, provisional restorations, you name it. And this computer assisted manufacturing, your computer aided manufacturing, is into it. In fact, computer aided concept is applicable in many fields of dentistry. The first and foremost is computer-aided diagnosis. Then comes computer-aided treatment planning. Then comes computer-aided surgery. Then comes computer-aided manufacturing and computer-aided smile designing as well, or as we call it, computer-aided aesthetics. So as of now, this particular topic would talk about the various biomaterials related to manufacturing of the various restorations. And it's not in dentistry. Computer-aided manufacturing has come to rescue a lot many things in the COVID pandemic era. The test swabs, the face shields, the medical equipment parts have been very fastly and efficiently printed using this particular technique. Before computer-aided manufacturing came into picture, that is before the digitalization came into dentistry, how did we restore anything? A cavity was restored either by direct placement or layering of material or by casting through lost wax technique. Now, what do we need to have before we start with computer-aided manufacturing? The first point tells us CAD software allows us to create objects from scratch. This is very applicable when we are talking about fabricating a computer-assisted maxillofacial prosthesis. Then volumetric data in the form of CT scan or through CBCT for surgical guides, for drilling guides. And then if we are talking about crown and FPDs, then intraoral optical surface scan data, lab optical scan data through the various intraoral scanner and the lab scanners come into picture. So these are the five basic things through which the data is acquired for a computer-aided manufacturing is to be done. Now, computer-aided manufacturing, since the topic is about biomaterials, just in very brief, what computer-aided manufacturing, how many types of computer-aided manufacturing is there? There are two types. One is additive and the other is subtractive. Additive is commonly or popularly known as rapid prototyping or 3D printing. And when I say the word 3D printing, it actually prints. It builds up the object layer by layer, and those layers get fused to each other by heat transmission through laser. So there are various techniques of doing this additive manufacturing. A product manufactured through additive manufacturing will have minimal wastage of material. There are customization options, and obviously the resultant product will have improved mechanical properties as compared to the lost wax technique procedure. But then there is a catch out here. The catch being, not all the CAD-CAM, that is not all the computer-assisted manufactured products are the best. The clinical trials for a lot many products are still on. So as clinician, we need to understand that before we launch ourselves into this particular digital aspect of dentistry, we should be aware that which product is good, and not just believe the representative or the lab person, or leave it to the lab person to decide upon the material. knowing your material and knowing the indications and the advantages of the material for a particular case with relevance to a particular clinical case is very important. Dental material is a subject which, according to me, forms the backbone of dentistry. Everywhere we work, we need to work with dental material. If I talk about surgery, then a very small thing, suture. If a student is not aware about the various suturing material, their properties, then the application of those suturing material will be zero and it would be a failure of that case. So knowing your material is as important as knowing the process. So in this presenting scenario, knowing the CAD and knowing the CAM is important, but knowing the biomaterials for CAD and CAM is equally important. Then subtractive milling technique, it has many advantages, but then it has a major disadvantage, as you can see in the figure, that it leads to a lot of wastage, because in subtractive technique, you get a block, and if you want to make a candle out of it, the rest of the material goes waste. Whereas in printing or additive manufacturing, you get powder particles and you form that powder particle into a shape of a candle. So the wastage is quite less. Now coming on to the biomaterials for subtractive manufacturing, these, the conventional material that we use as of now, are either in powder liquid form, water powder ratio, paste form, or a cake form. Whereas these milled materials, they come in millable materials, they come in various shapes and sizes. And the raw material which is to be milled in a milling machine is referred to as a stock. Stock, as we say, stock tray, customized tray. So it is called as a stock. And it is available in various forms. One is a small block, as you can see on the picture on your right, the first one, it is a small block. Out of this particular small block is used for chair side milling. I'll come to that, what is chair side milling and what are the other form of milling. So this is a small block, and out of this block, maybe two or one small and one more small inlay may be milled out of it. Then it,
hello,
the second picture,
Hello, ma'am, your screen is not sharing, ma'am. Please share your screen.
I had shared my screen. I'll do it again. Just a minute. So present now your entire screen. Is this visible?
You are visible fully, ma'am, but you not. Yes, screen is visible.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you want me to go back or should I continue from here?
Continue, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So as I was saying, these raw materials are milled in a milling machine, and these raw materials are referred to as a stock before they are converted into a restoration through computer-assisted manufacturing. So they are available, as you can see on the right side, there is a small block. This is used for chair-side milling, and the rest two pictures are used for lab milling. The difference between lab milling and chair-side milling is, as the name suggests, it is a tabletop equipment which you can have it in your clinic. It uses smaller sizes of material and the quality of material is also different. I have talked about the few of the differences later on. So one, when we talk about subtractive manufacturing, is that the raw material is referred to as a stock. Then depending upon the material which is to be milled, the milling is either wet milling or dry milling. A wet milling means that the material is milled under copious water. Otherwise, too much rise in temperature would disturb the properties. Whereas a dry milling does not require any kind of water to cool down the temperature because the type of material used is totally different. So these are some of the materials which can be milled. The wet milling, zirconia can be milled either through wet or dry. Then polymethyl methacrylate, feldspathic porcelain, lithium disilicate, titanium, cobalt chromium, and hybrid composite. They all require wet milling. Dry milling, wax, composite resin, gypsum, cobalt chromium alloys, and glass fiber composite. Now, coming on to the differences between chairside milling and lab milling. Chairside milling, as I just mentioned, it requires smaller blocks, because the instrument into which this particular raw material is fixed is small. So chairside milling requires smaller blocks, whereas lab milling, in one go, it requires disc. Chairside milling generally takes care, generally uses pre-sintered or pre-crystallized blocks. Now, what does a pre-sintered or pre-crystallized block signify? It signifies that the material is soft, so it would be milled easily and faster, which is a requirement for a chairside milling. In a lab, you can either use a pre-sintered or maybe a fully sintered block. A pre-sintered block, once milled, will require a sintering treatment to enhance the mechanical properties. Whereas a lab milling, if it is a fully sintered block, then it will not require any post-milling sintering process. The block which is used for chairside milling at times may not be applicable for the lab milling because of their shape and size. Chairside milling, sintering time for zirconia is 20 minutes through the rapid sintering machine marketed by a couple of companies. Then lab milling, the sintering time for zirconia is 8 hours. Now coming on to the various materials, specifically ceramics. Classification of computer-aided manufactured ceramic, milled ceramic. The conventional ceramic can be classified into predominantly glassy ceramic, particle-filled glasses, polycrystalline ceramic. Whereas if you want to simplify for computer-assisted machining, then these three on your right, feldspathic, leucite, and lithium disilicate, these are basically modifications of aluminosilicate glass. Then you also have zirconium oxide and lithium silicate reinforced. And then you have polycrystalline ceramic, which is zirconia, and it comes in different percentages of yttrium, 3, 4, and 5. I'll talk about the importance of each one of these. Feldspathic porcelain. Very low strength. It is a glassy ceramic. The plasticized mixture is pressed. How are the blocks made? The plasticized ceramic mixture is pressed and extruded through a nozzle to give a form which are dried before sintering. Drawback, low strength. Advantages, good aesthetics. But then, since it has a very low strength, it is generally not used for lab milling, chairside milling, and that too not much in use, because there are better aesthetic looking material which are available with better strength. So moving on to leucite reinforced porcelain. This is a type of glass only, but this is a particle filled glass. So what particles are there and from where do these particles come? Glass is heat treated. It is very easy to understand the process of ceramic. Glass is heat treated, and when it is heat treated, a controlled and partial crystallization happens. The crystals of leucite, according to that heat treatment, are formed inside the transparent matrix of glass, giving it a translucency, and this particle of leucite, it reinforces the porcelain. As you can see to the picture on your right top screen, you would see small finger-like projections. These are precipitated leucite particles. What are the advantages of leucite? The index of refraction is very close to feldspathic glass, so translucency is there. It etches at a much faster rate than the base glass, so a good micromechanical bond is created, and also it enhances the strength and minimizes the crack propagation, so minimizes the fracture of porcelain, because that is one of the major disadvantages of porcelain, which is propagation of crack, due to which this brittle material or any kind of porcelain tends to fracture. The advantages are excellent aesthetics. As I said, all the glass ceramic will have excellent aesthetics, but they would always be low on strength. So the indication is always aesthetic areas with low stress. It should always be remembered, glass ceramic, then the indication are low strength areas where aesthetics is a major concern, and the acid etching or the bonding technique is very important. After feldspathic leucite comes lithium disilicate. So from feldspathic leucite, and now lithium disilicate is also prepared when glass ceramic are heat treated in a particular cycle, they undergo crystalline transformation in this case to form lithium disilicate, because the heat treatment differs. The glassy matrix is reduced to 30% of the volume. Since the glassy matrix is reduced to even lesser amount, the strength of lithium disilicate is way better than the strength of leucite reinforced or the feldspathic, where it was 160, here it starts from the range of 360 megapascal. Monolithic, that is single body restorations, may be fabricated, veneers, inlays, onlays, endocrowns, anterior and posterior crowns. Posterior crown, you need to do it with a lot of caution. Why? Because the strength is still not in that range to maybe not able to sustain the masticatory bite forces. But a lot of clinicians with good bonding technique have started shifting to lithium disilicate for even posterior restorations as well. The clinical trials are still going on, and anything conclusive would be there. So the treatment before placement, this is very important. Hydrofluoric acid, feldspathic, is 9.6% for 1 minute. For leucite, it is 4.9% for 1 minute. And for lithium disilicate, it is 4.9 for 20 seconds. It is very easy to understand why the time period or the percentage of hydrofluoric acid decreases. Glass is etchable only by hydrofluoric acid. Glass cannot be etched by any other acid except hydrofluoric acid. So as you move from feldspathic to lithium disilicate, the percentage of glass is decreasing. So the amount of or the percentage of hydrofluoric acid and the time required for acid etching would decrease. After acid etching, they would be placed in ultrasonic bath, and then a silane coupling agent and a resin curing cement to be used for bonding these materials. Then there is one, zirconium oxide and lithium silicate. The previous one was lithium disilicate. This one is lithium silicate with 10% zirconium oxide. As we all know that zirconia is a metal. It is a type of metal in the periodic table. And it was earlier referred to as carbon steel because of its high strength. Such ceramic are also named as ZLS. After wet milling, the final dual lithium silicate microstructure is reached during an 8-minute firing process at 840 degree Celsius. So this again is a reinforced feldspathic porcelain in which zirconium oxide and lithium silicate by heat treatment are incorporated. And I think by now you would understand that the properties of silicate cement, as we move from feldspathic to ZLS, the fracture toughness increases. All the properties would increase as the percentage of glass from feldspathic to leucite to lithium disilicate to zirconium oxide lithium silicate would decrease. More of glass, less of strength. Less of glass, more of filler particle, better strength. And as we know, more of filler particle, strength would always be good. This is after the patient comes out from your clinic with a lithium disilicate crown. Now moving on to a very burning topic, that is zirconia. Many lab people, many technicians have this thing that the dentist, when they send their cases, they are like, "Isko all ceramic mein kar dena." Many of them are not so aware about which material is best for which scenario. Like the materials which I have discussed, they are the silicate ceramic or the silicate porcelain. They are best for low stress bearing area, medium stress bearing area, where aesthetics is a major concern. Zirconia is a very strong material. As I said, it was earlier referred to even as carbon steel because of its high strength. So it is a material where high stress would be there, high occlusion load would be there. But nowadays, manufacturers have modified zirconia and have added more of translucent agent to make it aesthetic looking. But in that process, the aesthetics is decreasing a bit. Their aesthetics is not as good as lithium disilicate. But yes, with newer zirconia, as the amount of zirconia is decreasing and the amount of other material is increasing, this material is also being advocated where aesthetics is a requirement. So cold pressed zirconia, they are soft material. They are prepared by pressing the powder particles together. It is easy to mill. In fact, it is very chalk-like. Before milling, if you get to touch this material, you will feel a chalky substance on your fingers. So it is very easy to mill. When it is easy to mill, it is easy for the lab people because the burrs do not get abraded very fastly. Whereas a harder material would make their burrs wear faster. So that adds up to the cost. Once it has been milled, it is sintered to make an extremely strong material. Then one more property you should know about this particular material is that all these materials undergo some amount of shrinkage. And what is that some amount of shrinkage? That some amount of shrinkage is mentioned on that particular block. So either your software would be designed to feed in that much of shrinkage, or you'll have to manually do that. Shrink factor has to be incorporated, otherwise the prosthesis will be a misfit. Now, there is another type of zirconia. These zirconia blocks are manufactured when this material is pressed under high temperature. This material would be harder to mill, extremely difficult to mill, would take a longer time and would be expensive to mill. Why expensive? Because the milling burrs would wear faster, so they add to the cost. They would occupy the milling unit for a longer duration because a greater time period is required for the milling of these material. Generally, it is the cold pressed zirconia which is preferred by these labs. About zirconia, these are few things which we should always keep in mind, that it is a metal. Anything which is a metal cannot totally replicate the aesthetic property. Only when the amount of zirconia is lessened, then only the aesthetics comes into zirconia. Yes, it is white in color. The shade matching, if done through staining, then yes, at times, many a times, now with more predictable technology, the shade matching comes out very neat and nice. Strength of this material has made it popular. As I'm repeating it again and again, this is a very strong material. Greater the strength, lesser would be its translucency. So when you want greater strength, then and you know that the material would be slightly not so aesthetic looking, then you can shift this material to apply it for molars. When you want the material to have greater aesthetics, then a modification of zirconia can be used. It exhibits transformation toughening and it interrupts the propagation of cracks. Transformation toughening is very interesting to understand. If you look at this yellow picture, Then zirconia, when it melts, it undergoes phase transformation to cubic, then to tetragonal, and then to monoclinic. Just remember these phase transformation. Now we shift to the blue section of this presentation. The volume expansion caused by the cubic to tetragonal to monoclinic induces large stresses, and these stresses cause zirconium to crack upon cooling from high temperature. Meaning, if we use zirconia, melt it and let it cool, then when it is cooling, there would be phase transformation from cubic to tetragonal and monoclinic. So when it is cooling, there would be expansion of volume. This volume expansion leads to introduction of stresses, due to which there is propagation of cracks and the material would fracture. So to overcome this, they have this technology in which they stabilize zirconia by addition of yttrium oxide, which is known as, now this zirconia would be known as partially stabilized zirconia or PSJ. Hello everyone, since I cannot see you all, is this presentation making any sense?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. So, to zirconia is added yttrium oxide to partially stabilize it and to prevent it from fracture upon cooling. As you can see, from strong to aesthetic, as the percentage of yttrium increases, as the percentage of alumina decreases, but the cubic phase crystal increases, the strength of zirconia slightly decreases. So, 3Y partially stabilized zirconia for load-bearing area. When it is 4, then it is aesthetics plus load. And when it becomes 5Y partially stabilized zirconia, then it is lesser strength but more aesthetics. Now, this slide, I find it very interesting. As I mentioned, people would say that I am doing an all-ceramic restoration. All-ceramic is a very wide word. It is very wide. All porcelains are ceramic, but not the vice versa. Zirconia and porcelain should be understood differently. Porcelain is a type of silicate ceramic. Zirconia is a type of oxide ceramic. Zirconia is a type of oxide ceramic. Porcelain ceramic, they rely a lot on special bonding with the tooth structure. Whereas zirconia can even be conventionally bonded using a glass ionomer cement. Compared to zirconia, porcelain are lesser abrasive, more aesthetic, lesser strength, and they are more translucent. Cementation of zirconia restoration. Air particle abrasion with less than 50 μm particle. 2 bar pressure is recommended as a pre-treatment, followed by ceramic primer, which should contain MDP. What is MDP? 10-methacryl oxyl oxydecyl dihydrogen phosphate monomer that can bond to metal oxide. Are you paying attention to this? That can bond to metal oxide. What metal oxide is there? Zirconium, right? Zirconia is Zr2O3. Use of conventional glass ionomer as luting agent after cleaning can also be done, as is available in the literature. Now, as I have been mentioning sintering again and again. So what is sintering? Sintering is a heat treatment with or without the application of external pressure, whereby a system of individual particles or a porous body modifies some of its properties in the sense of moving towards a state of maximum compactness, and in the process it gives good properties, better mechanical properties to that material. After ceramic, we shift to wax. These are the other millable materials. Wax is used for fabrication of wax pattern. It is mainly composed of acrylate polymers. It is available in various colors, but a definite guideline on these milled waxes is still to come up in the literature. Then you have polymethyl acrylic resin. Nowadays, everyone is talking about complete denture. Maybe a digitalization aa gaya. You can get your complete denture totally milled with a computer-assisted manufacturing. Yes, it is there, but there is still a big learning curve, and there is still a lot of progress which needs to be done. A lot of clinical trials to finally prove the efficacy. So these acrylic resin are available in various, as you can see on this diagram, these are the various discs of different colors of acrylic resin available. The transparent one is used to test the fit or as a surgical guide. The tooth shaded is to mill a temporary crown and bridge. The pink acrylic is used to fabricate the denture base portion of a complete denture or a RPD framework. And then you have two shade material, that is pink and tooth color, in which a complete denture can be milled along with the tooth and the denture base. There is no need to separately attach the teeth in their sockets. CAD-CAM complete denture. These milled PMMA, how they are better than the conventional PMMA? They are produced under high pressure and heat, which prevents shrinkage of the definitive milled prosthesis. There is decrease in free monomer. There is decrease in the porosity as these milled PMMA blocks or discs are produced under high pressure and heat. And due to this, they display superior strength, better fit, better surface characteristics as compared to conventional PMMA denture. Now, there are two ways of milling it. As I mentioned, the teeth and denture base can be milled separately and then bonded, right? Or they can be milled in two-shade material. And it has been seen that milled complete dentures exhibit better adaptation as compared to printed complete denture. And what is this picture on the right side top screen? This picture is the try-in denture. This picture is the try-in denture. This try-in denture is used as a final try-in stage, is used during final try-in stage for checking the various parameters, the placement of teeth, the centric occlusion, the adaptation of the denture bases. And once this is checked and finalized in the patient's mouth, now this would be converted into a aesthetic looking denture. So as you can see in this particular picture, there are three pictures. The first one on your right shows a two color disc. The teeth as well as the pink denture base are milled in one go. Then on your left, the top one, it shows a milled denture base with the sockets, and into these sockets the pre-decided teeth is placed and cured. And on the right side, the lower one, it shows a printed try-in denture. And what are those white Y or T or I shaped bars? These are the support bars which are used, which are there when printing of such a process is done. After wax, after resin, that is PMMA, we come on to composite resin. These composite resin, what you need to know is that when a milled composite resin is used in the patient's mouth, the conversion rate of monomer to polymer is 90 to 95, whereas when we do a direct composite resin placement in the patient's mouth, then the conversion rate is just 50 to 60. And then when we send it to the lab for indirect composite inlay, then the conversion rate is 70 to 80. So a milled composite inlay, composite resin inlay and onlay, is stronger because of the high percentage of conversion rate. Since they are comparatively softer than metal or zirconia, they are easy to mill and they do not require sintering treatment, just a bit of polishing and stain placement. It has been seen that these composite resins can be used as long-term provisional restoration, and the estimated clinical life is 3 years for such materials. Then comes infiltrated ceramic resin. I would say as much research is being done on designing and manufacturing, The same amount of research is being done with various combinations of resin and their fillers. Now, those fillers can be just barium glass, or those fillers can be zirconia, those fillers can be alumina, and all of them have a different name. At times, you would find a resin which goes by the name of glass fiber reinforced resin, or you would find a resin named by polymer infiltrated resin. As the name suggests, understand the name and you would know what this material is about. As polymer infiltrated with ceramic. Polymer infiltrated with ceramic, meaning the matrix is polymer, it is infiltrated with ceramic particle. Then ceramic infiltrated with polymer, meaning ceramic network is infiltrated with a polymer. They have good mechanical properties, hand polishing required after milling, easy to repair in the mouth. That is one advantage of resin, which is not there with ceramics. What is that advantage? That it is easy to repair. Simply by abrading that area in the patient's mouth, applying the bonding agent and all that stuff, you can build up the fractured part. So ceramic infiltrated resin, that is ceramic matrix has been infiltrated with resin. It is pre-treated with aluminum oxide particle abrasion followed by silane. And when it is resin matrix infiltrated with ceramic, then it is acid etching. Wear resistance is less as compared to the resin infiltration. Resin infiltrated ceramic can also be used for single crowns, whereas ceramic infiltrated resin are recommended for smaller restorations. Then comes a very much talked about topic, PEEK. PEEK seems to be the master of all the restorations. You want a custom tray, you get PEEK. You want implant, you can use PEEK. You want an abutment on implant, you can use PEEK. You want a substructure on implant, you can use PEEK. So PEEK seems to be the solution for all the kind of fabrications. As of now, the clinical trials are still going on. There are no long-term trials, so use it with caution. Use it with caution, but this material definitely has some very good properties. These are all the good properties of PEEK. PEEK, polyether ether ketone. PEEK, polyether ether ketone. Fracture resistance of CAD-CAM milled PEEK is much higher than ceramic and zirconia. These are all the snippets from the various research articles I've read. But a long-term clinical trial of a lot of studies is still pending. So use this material, but use it with a lot of caution. Low modulus of elasticity is a very good property of this material, as it allows the absorption of functional stresses by deformation and acts as a stress breaker, reducing the forces transferred to the abutment teeth. So it is very kind on implants. It is very kind on implants. After PEEK comes chrome cobalt. What is bio-HPP? Bio-HPP stands for bio high performance polymer. Its base material is PEEK. It is a stronger form of PEEK. It is also a very upcoming material, and you name it and they would mill it. This is what I could conclude from the various articles about this material as to how good this material is. Again, long-term clinical trials are missing. Now shifting to metal. Zirconia was a metal. Now this is a different metal, or rather this is an alloy. Chrome cobalt alloy. Milling a chrome cobalt alloy can be a very tedious and a time-consuming task. But then they have blocks which are soft in pre-sintered form. So this enables rapid machining. This material also undergoes shrinkage upon sintering. So this has to be fed into, you make an oversized framework, and when you sinter it, then it becomes 10%. That much amount of maths you'll have to do there. Post-milling processing is slightly tricky. Thermal treatment under argon and degassing if it has to be layered with porcelain. Time consuming, tool life can be relatively short. Titanium. Pre-milled abutment. The abutments can be customized using these pre-milled blocks. Post-milling process is sandblasting, oxidation wait period, and application of a bond coat prior to applying specially designed porcelain, which means that this this abutment once milled would require some amount of surface treatment before porcelain can be applied onto this milled abutment. Precious metal alloys are not machined, they are not developed for this. Cost is one of the factors, and the other being other factor being that so much heat is being produced during the milling. So one of the articles mentioned that these material, their melting temperature is not so high, so it leads to deformation, and that is one of the more reason as to why precious metal alloys are still not being milled. Polyurethane, just for record, not very popularly used as a milling material because we have 3D printing technology. This particular table is sums up. This particular table sums up which material are millable, what form they are present in, what kind of milling do they require, what kind of tools do they require, where they are indicated, and what are the various post-processing treatments required for this for the various materials. Post-milling, mechanical polishing, glazing, and cutback. Now we come on to additive manufacturing, which, as I said, is popularly known as rapid prototyping or 3D printing. It builds the object layer by layer. And what is this picture on the left? It shows a DMLS, direct metal laser sintered crown with the support, and these small projections. Don't confuse them with screws. Printable material. Printable material, the material decides the printing method. Meaning, there are different printing techniques, but not all the materials can use those printing techniques. If it is a fused deposition modeling in which the material is extruded through a nozzle and applied layer by layer, then the material used is polylactic acid, ABS, polycarbonate, and PEEK. These materials are used for fabricating model, for learning a purpose, for counseling the patient, for a surgeon to see, and for simple, non-complex anatomical parts. Then there is stereolithography. It uses liquid resin, and the laser heat joins layer by layer. The material used are resins for photopolymerization and ceramic film material. It is used for fabricating models, surgical guides and splint, crowns and aligners and retainers. Then is selective laser sintering. Selective laser sintering can be divided into two. One is selective laser sintering, wherein polymer powder is used. The other is direct metal laser sintering, where metal powder is used. All these are used for fabrication of coping, FPDs, and resin partial denture frameworks. One good thing about the powder used in direct metal laser sintering is that they are MRI friendly, meaning that if the patient has a crown made out of DMLS technique, then that crown would not interfere during MRI scan. Then we have polyjet printing. They are the highest form of printing because they give us the best resolution. The material is cured through ultraviolet, and the material used is liquid photopolymers. Then a very interesting aspect in printing is bioprinters. The potential application is cell-laden scaffold for hard and soft tissue printing. So as you can see in this table, I have tried to classify the printing material as per their technique. A light cured resin can be printed through SLA, that is stereolithography, by photojet and digital light processing, light through a projector. A polymer powder can be processed through a selective laser sintering, nylon composites and elastomer. A metal powder can be sintered or 3D printed through direct metal laser sintering, cobalt chromium and titanium powder. A thermoplastic resin uses a fused deposition modeling, and a useful example for that is PEEK is used to, PEEK uses fused deposition modeling for 3D printing. 3D printing is applicable in all the aspects of dentistry, in maxillofacial surgery, for models, guides, splints, implants, endodontic, for fabricating a guide for guided epicoectomy, endodontic access cavity preparation, for perio-specific, patient-specific printed surgical guide for gingivectomy procedure, smile designing, and even as a bioprinting device, even as a scaffolding for development of tissues in that area. Orthodontics as orthodontic aligner, 3D printed brackets, prosthodontic, many things, and also for reduced mouth opening or lip contracture by just simply scanning that area with intraoral scanner. So 3D printing is useful in almost every sphere of dentistry, but as compared to subtractive or the milling technology, the application of this is still in progress with many materials coming into picture. Like I did not mention ceramic in 3D printable material, because ceramic when printed leads to formation of a porous material which compromises its strength beside other properties. So ceramic zirconia is still in a backstage development. Then composite resin, some properties when printed would improve whereas others would decrease. Printing is generally being used for printing a model, be it for diagnostic purpose, be it for surgery, be it for reference. It is being used to print the wax pattern and then cast those wax patterns. This way, the post-processing of sintered metal is not required. These are the powdered cobalt chromium alloy for direct metal laser sintering. Surgical guide resin. Very interesting is maxillofacial prosthesis. 3D printing is revolutionizing this aspect of dentistry. Silicone infiltration, direct printable silicones. These are some of the material through which a prosthesis may be fabricated, or titanium printed to reconstruct the defect. Thank you so much. Hello.
Thank you, Swati.
Thank you, Swati.
At last, my voice is back. But I don't know why there's so much of noise.
Any questions?
Ma'am, a small question. Yes. About your experience with intraoral scanner and the impression taking through adhesion silicone or polyether.
Okay.
Ma'am, which one is better and what are the challenges?
This is in reference to fabrication of which prosthesis?
Ma'am, any crown or bridge?
I would always go through intraoral scanning.
Okay.
The fit of the prosthesis, if the designing is done nicely, comes out to be very good. I'm
Swati,
highly
can you hear me?
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
any more questions or should we just yes ma'am ma'am koi baat nahi ma'am ji ma'am ha nahi aa rahi aapki awaaz ha ha wo dikha certificate dikh gaya ha ji ma'am तभी मैम नहीं मैम तो इसको फिर लीव करें फिर आई लास्ट एवरीवन थैंक यू ओके सो थैंक यू एवरीवन देयर इज सम इशू विद डॉक्टर दिव्या मैम्स नेट एंड गूगल देयर इज सम इशू सो आई थिंक वी विल रैप अप दिस and if there is any question I would answer it otherwise bye bye have a great day and stay safe
thank you ma'am
thank you ma'am
thank you ma'am
thank you